Brady Bunch. We're meeting on Friday, March the 27th at 3 p.m. We have just one or two items on the agenda. The first thing I want to say is that earlier today I signed Emergency Order 2010. And what that does is it codifies how we're allowed to have these virtual meetings. We have no practical way of taking public input at this meeting. So, and we're working out the technical issues there. So what we're going to do is manage this the same way we did our previous emergency meeting online. And that is the commissioners and staff will provide input to myself and staff. And we will then take that input and make any amendments that seem necessary for the other emergency order, which is called 2009. It's been amended once. We're going to perhaps amend it a second time today. For those on the Zoom call, you can't see, but we have a sign language interpreter in the boardroom. And at the 1 hour point, I will be stopping the meeting to switch interpreters and give them a break. The and one thing I want to say right at the offset is we're going to get no guidance from the state or the federal government in the near term with respect to any of the policy issues that we'll be discussing today. It's the current position of the state that these decisions are best left up to left entirely to local governments. And we appreciate that acknowledgement that we can take care of our own situation and that we have the abilities to do so. And so with that, what I'm going to do, the other thing is, commissioners and staff, we are in self-mutation mode, which means that we're in charge of muting our own audio. And the way that works is you can touch the space bar and turn yourself on or off, or else there's a control on the screen. If you first touch the screen, then you can see the mute. So what I'm going to do is first ask each commissioner if there's any items that they need added to the agenda other than dealing with Emergency Order 2009, and then ask the staff the same question. So Commissioner Cornell, you're first.
No, I understand we're going to be talking about construction, realtors, perhaps car dealers, maybe golf courses, and then some wording. That's what I had on my list.
Okay, Mike?
Nothing to add.
Mary Helen? Mary Helen, you need to unmute. Hit the space bar. Hold it down. There you go. Hold it down. Or.
Okay. Oh, I hold it while I'm talking.
There you go.
Okay, I got it. Okay. Now I'm going to have to leave at about 3:20. 4:20, I'm sorry, because I'm on the canvassing board and I've got a meeting there at 4:30. But, you know, I don't have anything to add to that. I've been talking to a lot of young people who are really, really worried and are dealing with mental health issues as a result of what we're doing here. So we just keep that in mind as we're discussing it. There are a lot of fragile people out there listening.
Thank you. And Madam Manager, do you have anything else that you want to bring to our attention?
No, I think that list, Commissioner Cornell, I've got banks, construction, real estate, car dealers, Commissioner Cornell added golf courses. We did have in Commissioner Chestnut's letter, he brought up beauty parlors, that's on my list. And then the two issues of occupancy and staff screening.
Okay. And Sylvia?
Mr. Chair, I think that's everything.
Okay. So what we'll do is we have a draft that I think you all have of some amendments. And one of the things that
sorry to interrupt, is the issue that we mentioned at the last meeting regarding whether or not the occupancy limits apply to places of worship. Is that on the list that was just described?
You're correct. We need to add that as well.
I saw the proposed changes that I think came from Bob, who had some proposed language. If we take no action, are the changes or amendments going to just go through if we take no action?
Yeah, I'm in charge. So yeah, I think everything I've seen so far is fine. And until you guys tell me something different, and a bunch of you tell me something different, then we'll continue on the course we're on. What I will say about this is the retail friction we created with the with some of the particularly the shopping, the grocery shopping, the shock and awe of it worked. And I've been to probably 15 different grocery stores at different times of the day observing, and things are nowhere near as apocalyptic as some people are making them out to be. So with that, why don't we take these, Commissioner Cornell, why don't you take these in the order that you have them listed there, and why don't you introduce the first one?
Before I do that, Chair, I haven't seen any proposed change wording other than the two emails from the county attorney. Is there another one that I'm missing?
What I got was a Amendment 2 to Emergency Order 2009. And what that does is it basically, it's mostly some formatting changes and some just adding.
So I haven't seen that document, I guess, is my point.
Okay. Well, let me just say that it the main thing that it does is, instead of taking these different industries who have written to us, instead of taking their recommendations, what instead Bob Swain found was this document, which is brand new, hot off the press, and it provides guidance for all kinds of industries in here. And basically what they do is they categorize them into very high exposure risk, medium and lower exposure risk.
So I've read that document, Hutch. I'm familiar with that document.
Right. Yeah. So, well, just for people watching, then in each one of those, they provide some of the recommendations for personal protective equipment, for engineering controls, and for administrative controls and safe workplace practices. And these are just recommendations, but what the attorney has told me that we could actually adopt these as our standards, and then they become enforceable by codes enforcement officers, and I actually think it's a good way to go. These things only came out, not even a week ago. So they will probably be tweaked, but if we adopt them by reference as our standards as these change, then we will be able to sort of automatically incorporate those every time we readopt the emergency order, which we have to do once a week anyway. So that would be my recommendation, rather than have a separate list. I mean, I really appreciate, by the way, what GACR and the Builders Association and the car dealers and the others have brought to our attention. But it turns out that this may be a better way to go. And so what I've asked the attorney to write into the order is the following language, and that is: reference and mandate industry OSHA standards as or any subsequent standard by OSHA. This includes the use of OSHA guidance for COVID-19, and it's got the link to it. And then part two, which is our requirement, is require education of workers, employees by employers of the standards, and require that these standards be present on the work site. It's a very thin, it's about 30 pages or so. So notebook of these on the work site, everybody can get it. And then create an anonymous telephone report line for employees who believe that they are being required to work in substandard conditions.
I'm sorry to interrupt. I know I'm trying to figure out how to do this, but it sounds like you're starting into the first subject. Could I say something before we start into the list?
Please, go ahead.
Because I want to make sure that everyone has the same information. We're all playing off the same page. Commissioner Cornell, Commissioner Wheeler, did you all get the proposed amended language from Bob Swain?
I got the three things that Hutch just read, and I received the OSHA guidelines.
So, for instance, number 16 in the amended language speaks pretty far down the page, speaks to the issue of places of worship.
And I have not seen that.
And it makes the change that said that they must comply. It's not advised that they should, but that they must comply. Madam Attorney, jump in if I'm not characterizing that correctly, but that appears to be what is proposed. And if we don't act on that amendment, then the amended language, I'm assuming, will be the law, and that's what we're going to do. Is that correct?
I'm certain we're all talking from the same document. My preference is to talk, instead of from a document and amending a document, is to talk in generalities. Do we want them to have to comply? And right now we have something that says, that they're discouraged. And it says generally they're discouraged. In the draft that we have, it says that groups of 10 or more assembling are discouraged, including religious gatherings. I don't need that including because it's clearly included in that. But it's the same standard to all of them.
Well, if I may, number 16, I'm looking at it. It's underlined strike-through language. It says, while gatherings of 10 or more are discouraged, then goes on to say, any religious service must comply with all measures advised by the CDC, which I thought was 10 or more.
Again, I'm not sure which draft.
I'm looking at the Amendment 1 to the Emergency Stay-at-Home Order that was emailed by Bob Swain.
Okay, I got you, Mike. Yes, I've seen that. That's already been implemented. And I think one thing that we have discussed with the manager would be the simple way, if that's what we want to do, would be to strike 16, essentially, and just in 17 say groups of 10 or more are prohibited and may be ordered to disperse.
That's fine with me. The important thing, I think, is that we not distinguish on the social distancing requirements on the basis of what people are talking about.
Right. So Amendment 1 is the amendment that's already gone into effect. And I was looking at the new draft that we bring before you today.
I'm looking off Amendment 2, and that's the one that says, starts with pursuant to the governor's executive order, and then it goes on to say, all individuals should cease participation in social, well, it says should, cease participation in social or recreational gatherings of more than 10 people. For all gatherings of fewer than 10 people, individuals should practice social distancing. Groups of 10 or more may be ordered to disperse.
That sounds good. We have
shoulds and we have mays in there.
Yeah, as opposed, if we could get what you're reading emailed to us during this meeting, then we could all work off of that document, yeah, which I think is a good document.
I don't have Amendment 2. I'm not sure how I missed it, but I don't have it. Unless it was just emailed in the last half hour.
Okay, so we will send that to you right now.
Yeah, I got it in the last half hour also.
Okay.
So, just for clarity, Amendment 1 is in effect right now.
Correct.
2 is what we've been working on.
So unless, if I may then, so unless we change it, the current requirement would be that places of worship are no different from any other social gatherings. Correct, Sylvia?
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, I guess my concern is when you read the language social or recreational gatherings, there may be people who consider church neither of those but something else.
You prefer the new language. And when we send it to you, I think you'll see why.
New language, except as Hutch said, it should say must rather than should.
Right.
Because we need to make that change if that's what we intend.
Okay. Right.
Okay, and Hutch, how would you like us to ask to speak? Should we start talking or like wave? You're not really catching my waving, which I understand. You're not looking at the screen, but how would you like us to ask to speak?
Well, I'd prefer you not speak, but if you're going to, then I will pay more attention to the screen.
Okay.
And one way to do it is if you are wanting to speak, you could go ahead and unmute yourself. And if you're not trying to get on the queue, then mute yourself, and then I can just quickly scan and see these are the people that need to speak.
Okay, thanks.
So right now, theoretically coming to you in some form or another is Amendment 2, and in it, it's got this language on 16 that we just talked about, which I think is fine, other than we need to make these things more enforceable rather than being shoulds and mays. And then the other thing is, just referring to these OSHA guidelines, making them on a job site, and providing a line for somebody to call. Now, my question to the staff is, if we, if tomorrow we get 50 calls from people complaining about unsafe work practices, are we equipped to send people, or at least make the, a phone call to the businesses as a first step, then send somebody out there?
Yes, Mr. Chair, we have the portal set up and we have a process in place where any complaints are going to go be routed through that system to the appropriate people. So we have code enforcement who's prepared to start going out to those locations. So a lot of those will be routed to code enforcement.
Now, let me ask a question about enforcement, particularly with respect to construction. There's no amount of fine that will, in some cases, encourage them to shut down or do the right thing, unless, well, I mean, to what we need is the ability to shut somebody down right away. And is that something we need to put explicitly in this emergency order so that it's clear that that's essentially the penalty, not some $250 fine?
Mr. Chair, we had a conversation with the city attorney's office on that. We originally talked to you about adding in a citation line. They preferred that we didn't. They preferred that it was a choice between voluntary compliance and a criminal, basically arresting someone. They preferred that.
Well, I don't prefer that. First of all, we don't want to be arresting anybody. And second of all, we... the sanction for most businesses and particularly construction sites, the most severe sanction is, sorry, you have to send everybody home until you get this right. And until we do that, then I don't think we'll get compliance. And it's not that hard to comply with. All you have to do is post this document and have an educational program for your folks and then make sure they've got whatever the recommended gear is and safe practices. Most of them are doing it anyway. So I don't think it's going to be a problem, but the ones that are a problem, we need to be able to shut them down.
Right. So, Mr. Chair, they would have to respect a stop work order.
Yeah, exactly.
They would issue a stop work order for a violation, but they would have to respect.
So my question is, do we need to write that specifically in here, perhaps specifically with constructions, that we have the person enforcing it has the right to issue a stop work order?
I think that authority is in the order as it is. We'll look at it again to make certain. If you are more comfortable with it being spelled out, then we certainly can.
I think it needs to be explicit because I think that this order is getting read by people and that needs to be obvious. Because again, I'm going to guess that 90%+ of all construction sites will be fine. And it's actually, this is easier than some of the things that we were proposing. But it also, unless we've got those teeth, we may not get compliance. And we will get complaints from workers. I'm getting them already. So, Mike, you have your light on, your unmute button.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to.
Okay. So, Mary Helen.
Are we just talking about the building industry right now?
Go ahead and let's finish up with this. Do you have any questions about that?
But that's what I'm asking. Is this, are we talking about work sites
Yes.
that are mm-hmm. specifically building, or does that Yes. all work sites?
Well, right now, mostly construction, but any work site.
Okay, gotcha. Thank you.
And then, Ken, did you want to speak to this?
So I've read what Bob has sent. I'm okay with I and J. That looks good. I think the issue with the construction is existing construction sites. Is it your intention, Hutch, to limit those or to continue those as long as they're following these guidelines?
Well, I think that these guidelines are the best thing we have, and I think I don't have any problem with anybody if they're operating under these. I think they come well vetted.
So I think that's right. So I think if you go to paragraph 6, which in the amended order you added required in response to public health. I think if you just said existing construction and struck the rest of that sentence up into the semicolon, then that basically means that if you're constructing things now, follow the guidelines. And I know we're limiting new things coming online, but I think that accomplishes what your intent is. With regards to the realtors and the builders, I know that this, I think, would suffice with what you added in I and J. I think they intend to kind of strengthen some of these requirements because they're actually recommending questioning and screening. They're shutting down all open houses. And so from the standpoint of what is practically happening on the ground, I think by making your change and then by the things that the association is pushing out to the brokers and what they've actually been doing for the last 2 weeks, I think we get there.
Okay. All right.
I'll give you a grocery comment. I think grocery stores we need to have one whole discussion on. And I've got, I'm mostly concerned about the employees and screening the employees for the protection of food. There seem to be some points in the grocery stores like you. I visited about 15 of them over the last 3 days, and I do have some comments about that. I can give them now, or I can wait till we get to that.
All right. Let's go ahead and talk about grocery stores. Go ahead.
Okay. So I think similar to restaurant takeouts, childcare facilities, we should be asking or requiring the screening of employees. We should be providing or asking the employers to provide protective gear and allowing them to wear it. I think that the reality of this situation is that if we have a positive case in a grocery store, there is the potential that the health department could shut that grocery store down. And so the current limitations could, you know, become a lot greater if we're not careful. So I think we need to protect those folks. I was in line yesterday and I told them they're one of our frontline people. And so a number of the stores during the day were no problem. I think the points where there's a lot of lines is early in the morning. And so to the extent early in the morning could be kind of reserved for our essential workers, folks before work and after work. The non-essential workers and retired folks, if they went in the middle of the day, that would help an awful, awful lot. So I think there's some messaging there. Many of the stores, there wasn't any problem, but like I said, early in the morning, there was. But for me, it's mostly about protecting the employees and making sure that we're screening the employees so that the food is not contaminated. So those are my initial comments.
Okay. Mike.
Yeah. Like y'all probably, I did a few grocery store crawls the last couple of days and probably visited a dozen, stood in line at most of them just to see what was happening, how the experience was going on. All of my visits were between noon and 8. Shouldn't surprise any of you. I wasn't out there at 7 o'clock in the morning with the seniors. When I anecdotally, I heard over and over and over and over, that's when the problem is, as Commissioner Cornell suggested, people in line waiting for the store to open. Of the dozen or so stores I went to, which was pretty much all the county, including the city of Alachua, except for the Northwest Gainesville, the longest line I encountered was 14 people in Alachua. And the next longest line was 6, and it went down from there. So we're looking at 3-5, worst case scenario, 10-minute waits to get in. So the first couple of store managers I spoke to when I identified myself wouldn't talk to me. They referred me to their, public relations folks. So I wasn't able to get anything official. I just talked to every employee that I could. And everyone seemed to confirm that. Other than the first thing in the morning, particularly seniors on Tuesday and Wednesday, it seemed to be really no problems in any of the places that I went. I don't know if that applies elsewhere. Having said that, two thoughts. I had even in the short 3 to 5 minute waits that I had far more at-risk exposure to people in line than I did in the store, by far. Factor of 10, factor of 100. You're standing in line it's not, you know, they have tape 6 feet apart, but even 6 feet is not great, and it's highly variable. People are moving, pulsing, going back and forth. Everyone coming to get in the line tends to walk down the line to the end of the line to get in, and you can't do anything about that. You can't distance yourself anything more from that group and getting in and out the door. Once I got into the store, without exception, I was easily able to keep 10, 15 feet between myself and anyone else if I wanted to. On those rare occasions when you're passing someone in an aisle, you're within the zone for like a second. And the entire time in the store, it might have been 10 seconds where I was inside the zone for someone, compared to 5 minutes or 10 minutes or whatever you're spending in line. So for me, the primary problem in terms of exposure that I think we're experiencing right now are the lines. And particularly if we've got 60 and 70 seniors in line first thing in the morning, that is far and away, it seems to me anecdotally, and not anecdotally, it's my personal experience, that and any of you can disagree if you didn't have this experience, that's where the risk is, not in the store. And we could significantly increase the number of people in the stores without even coming close to the exposure that you're getting in the lines. I think if we bumped up the capacity, the occupancy limit by 10%, 20%, most of the lines would disappear altogether except these morning senior lines. And that's a separate problem we have to find a way to deal with. So I think that we should, having said that too, the second point I wanted to make was the fact that the lines are so short tells me that already people are kind of self-adapting. If we didn't have the occupancy limit, the stores would look pretty much the way they do now. If there's 5, 6, 7 people in line and there's no requirement for a line, they go in the store, it looks the same. People are going to the store once a week now instead of 5 times a week. People are doing the things that we think they ought to be doing already without the occupancy restriction, or else the lines will be longer. So if we do away with the occupancy restriction or significantly increase it, one, I don't think we have much more risk to the public health. Two, we get rid of the lines where the exposure is. And again, I'm wide open for suggestions about how to deal with the primarily seniors gathering first thing in the morning. That's something the stores, I guess, adopted on their own. And I don't know if there's anything we can or should do about that other than to work with them to explain that that is not having the intended effect. It's having the opposite of the intended effect. That's what I've got. Thanks.
Mary Helen.
I went to some stores too. I had Publix and I went to Save-A-Lot and Aldi's to see about their lines. But I went between 2 and 4 and we didn't have the lines. I think when I went to the Publix on 13th and 39th, there was 2 people waiting. And I talked to the young man who was doing the counting and asked him about how people were responding to the wait time. And he said that they hadn't had any problems since the first day, and that the stockers were enjoying it because that gave them a chance to keep the shelves full with the limited number of people in there. So I agree, timing, the time of day, I think has a whole lot to do with it. And by opening up to seniors in the morning, that's also the time when people who are trying to get to work are getting breakfast or whatever it is they need for their day. So the workforce is getting combined with the seniors who were there thinking they were going to get special consideration. So I think the timing issue may be, I hate to call cut back on what we've said, because by saying what we've said, we're saying this is really important. And I would hate to go back and say now, okay, well, maybe it's not as important as we thought. But I'm here to learn. But I just want you all to know that I did go out too, but it was between 2 and 4.
And I'll tell you the observation that I had, and I did spend some time taking classes in systems engineering back in the day, is the throughput through the checkout line needs to equal the number of people coming into the store. And that's how you sort of optimize the situation. If they're queuing up inside the store, then you're letting too many people in. And the analog to this is in most countries other than the United States, if there's an entry ramp onto a highway, we just let everybody get on there until the traffic stops. And in most other countries, they have a gate or a light system that once the speed on the highway gets below 30 miles an hour, let's say, some set point, the gate drops, nobody else gets on there, and actually more people get home quicker under that system than what we do, which is just let everybody in, jam it up. And so that's kind of the theory of creating some friction at the loading end of things so that the process stays more efficient. And so that's why I think it's working fine. The idea of exposure in the line, I didn't sense that wherever I was. Most of the people were, you know, there was a ribbon, they had to walk on the other side of the ribbon, and the ribbon was forced people to be 5 or 6 feet away as they were walking by. So and most of the overhangs, at least at Publix and Winn-Dixie and so forth, are 10, 12 foot wide overhangs. And if they would get their merchandise and junk out from under there, they would have a full width for the separation that's necessary. I'm concerned about anything we do to change that right now will be county eases up on grocery stores, go for it. And I don't really want to send that signal either. So I'm happy with the current system. I literally had nobody in the stores, employees in the stores complaining about it. I've heard from the corporate folks at Publix, and of course they would like just to do signage and that sort of thing, and I don't think that's enough. So I'm a big fan of our current retail friction experiment, and until somebody shows me that it's not working, I think it is working. So,
Hutch, may I? Yeah. Mm-hmm. I also spoke with folks at Walmart, some of the workers at Walmart, and they are feeling better about, you know, the numbers that are coming in, but they're also still worried about the close proximity to the people that are coming in and standing in front of them. From what I understand from one young woman, Walmart is told them they can't wear face masks or gloves because the plastic in the gloves is what's going to be transmuting or transferring this virus. So again, the workers, I think, have to be considered in this as well. It's not just the people who are there to, it's just not the shoppers, it's the people who are actually running the show.
And we need to write into our emergency order that no employer shall deny an employee the right to use personal protective gear, including face masks, shields, or gloves. I mean, I think we need to write it in there, because if that's really going on.
Well, and we can certainly check with the supervisors over there to see if that is indeed what is being said, because I was making face masks and was going to hand this child one, and she said, no, they're not, they won't let us use them.
Well, then I think we need to add that. I will add that into the next emergency order unless I hear any objections. No employee shall be denied the right to use personal protective gear. And
Coach, I know Publix is already screening the employees, but I think that's also important that they're being screened.
Yeah, I think that's important too. But that's on the side of management doing that. And we've already put into our order that management has the right to screen anybody, customers, employees, and deny access to anybody who registers. Screening nowadays is non-invasively taking temperature and then asking a couple questions. And that's pretty much all screening is, and asking them if they have any symptoms.
Doing some simple math, most of the lines are in the, in this, at least that I've recognized, are in the smaller stores like Hale, the Main Street store, 39th and 13th, where the limit is 45 to 55 folks. Mm-hmm. So Hutch, what I'm hearing is you're not in favor of lowering that to even 750, which would increase the amount of occupancy by about 15 to 18 people, which would eliminate all the lines. You're not in favor of that at this point.
Well, first of all, I don't think it'll eliminate the lines. There's all these interesting feedback loops that happen. If you see a line outside, you may say, well, I'm not going to go during that line.
Not if it's 3 to 5 people, Hutch. It's really not a deterrent.
Well, I agree with that. Then you stop and you get after.
And that's what we're seeing. Again, as you all had a different experience.
So Mike, on that, there wasn't a grocery store that I didn't go to where I didn't wait for 3 to 5 people, but there was no problem. I didn't have the same issue with folks getting too close to me with 3 to 5 people. In fact, it was the opposite. People kind of spread out, and the awareness was good, and the employees were actually very thankful, to Mary Helen's point. So, and it didn't take more than a couple of minutes. I think the issue is early morning in these busy stores like Hunter's Crossing, Hale Plantation, where there's high traffic, and we have a combination of essential employees, retirees, and folks that are trying to get there before work.
What I would tweak that this way, 6 feet is kind of a number we've come up with to keep people apart. It's not a magic number. 10 feet's better. 12 feet's better. 15 feet's better. The closest I was to other people for a sustained period of time was during the line, and I think that's true of everyone who's shopping right now. Secondly, I didn't see any ribbons separating the flow of traffic. I went to a dozen stores, and I didn't see any of those. Maybe it's not the same ones you went to, Hutch, but what I observed, Ken, is once people were in line, yeah, they stayed on the tape spot, more or less. Again, too close as far as I'm concerned, but it's people coming to get in line. They don't swing around to the other side of the store and come from the side where the line's ending. They come up to the front of the store. They walk down the line. They get in the line the way people get in line. If there was some way to like shunt them away from around everybody, but I really don't think that's the main point. The main point is that 6 feet, and of course that varies from 4 to 8 constantly as people are moving, people standing on things, more than one person standing together. They're not 72 inches apart. They're clumped is the point. The most clumping we're seeing by far is in the line, even if they're small lines. And if they are small lines, what good are we doing by having the restriction? 5 more people in the store will be unnoticeable. So if we bump it up by that amount, do away with the line altogether, I think net, we're improving safety. We're reducing exposure. That rule doesn't apply to 50 or 60 people in line. We've got a completely different problem there. But if a nudge makes the lines go away, and again, short lines, and I went 3 or 4 places where there were no lines. I went to Winn-Dixie on South Main, and the day before yesterday, and they told me they had not any lines all day, including in the morning. So
how would you do that? How would you recommend Hutch be able to do that?
I asked the manager yesterday to kind of, rather than one person per 1,000 feet, which, you know, Hutch, you took a stab at it, and it wasn't far off, but you've acknowledged it was kind of an arbitrary figure. What we do is work from that. And I asked the manager to, I'm going to ask her to chime in here for a second, and try to translate that 1 per 1,000 feet into a percentage of occupancy. How does that work? And see what that number is, and then increase that by, say, 10%. We're all kind of, you know, we have to be somewhat arbitrary about this, but my goal is to get rid of the vast majority of the lines, even the short lines, if we can, because that's where exposure is greatest. So, Michelle, were you able to kind of translate 1 per 1,000 feet into percentage of occupancy, or rather capacity, maximum capacity?
Mr. Chair, so the maximum capacity is quite a bit more when I learned about how it was calculated, and it does differ by use. So, for example, this is a fire standard, so mercantiles are 1 person per 30 square feet, but it's usable space, so they subtract the shelving and the other items. So to do that, what fire does in looking at occupancy is they basically divide that number by 2. So when you look at a 40,000 square foot grocery store and you take, divide it by 2 to 20,000 square feet and get 1 person per 30 square feet, you actually can fit 666 people in that store. So 50% of occupancy is 333 people for a 40,000 square foot grocery store. That's quite a few people.
And how many are being let in under our one, it would be 40 people, I guess, under our 1 per 1,000 feet, which would be, I forgot your number already, but what, how does that trans, if we took one per 1,000 feet, what percentage of the maximum occupancy would that be?
Well, it'd be 40 over 330. Somebody do the math.
330 is half, right?
330 is half.
So we're down like, we're at 5 to 10% of maximum occupancy in the store, I'm guessing.
That includes employees.
Correct. So anyway, however, is the easiest way to do it that makes it explainable. What I'm suggesting is that if we've got 40 to 50 people in the store and we've got 3 to 5 people in line, increasing the number of people that we allow in by 10% is going to make a significant number of the lines go away.
No, well, it'll just change the behavior of the people. You know enough about traffic management.
Here's the thing. I do, but I don't think 3 to 5 people in line is a deterrent for anyone.
Right.
So it's not going to make one more person. I would have gone, but there were 5 people in line. So I went home and ordered online. That's not what they do. They get in line.
Right. But I also think if you, no matter what number you put there, there's going to be 3 to 5 people in line.
I don't agree.
I totally agree.
Because I don't think our,
it's the old triple convergence problem. I mean, that's the way it works.
I don't think our current restriction is generating the size of the current lines. If it were, there would be probably longer lines. There'd be a lot more people in line shopping than there are right now. People are already taking steps to not go to the store as often. And the fact that the lines are so short, it's not because of this. It's because people who used to go to the store 5 times a week. I know people like that. All of you do. They're not doing it anymore.
Yeah, the lines of time are in the morning and in the afternoon. Yeah. After work and before work. That's when the lines are.
Well, anyway, it's you know, it takes 3 of us to make a decision. I would increase it marginally. I don't think it tells the public that we're abandoning social distances. I think it tells the public that we're responding to appropriate feedback and making adjustments that are intelligent. And the lines are by far, even if they're short, are the worst place for a person to be when they're doing their grocery shopping experience. Let me add one other comment on that, on something that a few others of you have mentioned. In terms of unnecessary contact, I don't want to get anyone to lose their job or anything, but every store where I did go through the entire process, I had 2 people waiting for me there at checkout. One was the cashier and the other was someone to bag my groceries. I do not need a person to bag my groceries. Perhaps some people do. I bring my own bags. I load them up. It's not difficult. But here's this person standing 3 to 5 feet from me, handling my groceries, putting them in the bag. And so if we could communicate to stores that maybe someone could be ready to assist with bagging if requested. But otherwise, that person should be 30 feet away. So if we can communicate that to the stores in terms of how they process that, because that's, again, another choke point where every person is coming into contact with a couple of people at the checkout counter closer than 6 feet, a lot closer than 6 feet, and it's not necessary.
Okay.
Ms. Chair. A couple of things to be mindful of when we're making these decisions. Again, they apply to every essential service that we are allowing to operate. And so that's one. We can always say that we're doing something different for grocery stores or a certain type of store, but that right now they do apply to everything. And also to be mindful of the enforcement of these. So the more complex we get in doing math and as far as how many people can go into the store, the harder it gets for the enforcement of that. So set numbers or something that's easy to make a determination. But if we start talking 10%, 15%, and somebody has to stand there and do the math before we enforce it, I just want to be mindful of the practical side of that.
Well, I would say that I think it's a math problem you do once, and then the manager does it. He instructs employees, this is how many people can be in the store. That's what they did with the 1 in 1,000. So I don't think it would be that big a deterrent.
May I add?
Go ahead.
I went to Rural King. They can allow 92 in. The Publix over there on 39th was allowing 55. The Lowe's 150, and Save a Lot 10. And I went into the Dollar General store just to see if they'd had an increase in traffic because of the other store's limitations. They had their own limitations, of course, But they said, of course, that their business had increased as people were looking or being turned away or not wanting to deal with the numbers or the lines. So, you know, you're right. Rural King 92, Publix 55, all on that same stretch, and Lowe's 150 and Save-A-Lot 10. And I heard from someone who had said that they'd been into wards right after this came out and was challenging them on the 6 foot distance and how many were in the store and was escorted out. Hopefully that's changed since then, since it was new and people were not fully aware of their responsibility to the public, but that was the report I got.
Okay, thank you all very much. I think we got the input we need for
Ken,
now.
Ken, before we move on, Hutch, Ken, are you, I know it would be 2-2, even if you were, but Commissioner Chestnut may rejoin us at some point. What do you feel about the occupancy limit?
I think it's mostly a timing issue. And so I'm willing to give it another week to see if we can get through this next weekend. I am just in general most concerned that we do whatever we can to flatten the curve in the next two weekends. And I didn't see any significant reasons other than those times, early in the morning and late at night, to make any mandated changes from what we're currently doing. So that's where I am.
Yeah.
All right.
I would remind the board that this is just an input meeting, that we can't take an action at this meeting.
Right.
And that the authority is still with the chair.
Yeah.
So the next thing we should talk about is banks. And Madam Manager, you had some conversations with some banks, and I think some of the other board members have, and we've gotten some email on it. Can you tell us what you think the issue is and make a recommendation?
So, Mr. Chair, what we've heard is an expression of concern that with more people obtaining unemployment checks, as well as with an increased number of businesses applying for SBA loans or seeking SBA loans, that they believe there will be additional traffic to their location, and that many of the locations, they have the individual offices where somebody can go in and sit and be, not be waiting in the lobby. The other issue is we have one specific bank that has addressed concern, Bank of America, because they recently eliminated a lot of their drive-through service areas and change them to ATM, so they don't have the ability to take documents through those drive-through lanes any longer. So those were the primary issues. They felt that they had practices in place that would be beneficial, and that they that is sufficient.
Okay, so do you think we need to change anything in this order with respect to banks?
Mr. Chair, that's really a decision, or a discussion for the group to have. But that has been the request, is that we relax the occupancy requirements. But the concern that I have is we start saying, for this type of facility, we're going to allow this. For this type of facility, we're going to allow that. It's much easier on staff to enforce if we have something uniform. And if you're going to make an exception, make that exception limited, rather than saying we're going to pick this service and this service.
Well, I think the way banks might have to operate is if you don't want people stacking up in their waiting rooms, that what they probably need to do is go to a reservation system or set appointments or something like that. And that just may be the way of the future for a lot of businesses, to keep their lobbies from jamming up at certain peak times. And that would be how I would handle this thing and somehow get the word out that we want to do business with you, but you need to pick a number and come back or whatever they need to do. I mean, the Social Security office does that, and it works great. And they'll have 100 people in their lobby. But if you have an appointment, you walk right in and you get the appointment online. You walk right in and 50 people are giving you the dirty look, but you're the one who made the appointment. So I think that's what they'll need to do. So I'm not in favor of changing it just for banks right now. Let me just say something about how I think this emergency order is sort of its lifespan. Its lifespan is going to be as long as things don't get worse or don't get a lot better. And I was trying to find it. There's a Lancet article from about the Spanish experience. And basically what they did in Spain was they categorized every community as a A or B level. The A levels being, the ones that were rampant infection, things were, you know, moving quickly. And the B communities were often more rural communities and places where it just didn't have the ability to spread as quickly. And then they set certain criteria for infections per capita. And under their criteria, we are in that lower category, but if we continue to increase our numbers, we'll be in the upper category. And so they had recommendations for each of those categories. And basically the lower category, which we're in now, is kind of the order that we've got. It's like, yeah, you can have a lot of stuff open. You can, trust people to do the right thing most of the time and that sort of thing. As soon as you get to that rampant stage, you pretty much have to go to complete shutdown where all retail is closed, all construction is closed, all service industry is closed. You keep grocery stores open and pharmacies and healthcare facilities, and that's it. And so once we've kind of perfected our order, which I think this third meeting is going to help us do, this third iteration is going to help us do, I'm going to start working on the complete shutdown order and how that's going to work, because I think we will hit that trigger if things don't change. And essentially that's a warning to the community and the business community and everybody that things could get, if they do get a whole lot worse, we're going to have to do a whole lot more. And so we should call this the mama bear situation, and we don't want to have to deal with the papa bear. And so with that, so we had banks, we had...
Can I speak to that?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so I think making hard decisions sooner is where we need to be, and I think that's where you are right now. And I generally, while I don't agree with everything you're saying, I support the direction that you're going for that reason. Again, my biggest concern is the next 2 weeks, the next two weekends. And if we can slow the rate and flatten the curve in Alachua County, I don't think the state is doing the same things that we're doing. And so we're going to see an acceleration there. And I'll make some comments at the end of the meeting for my fellow colleagues in other counties that are close to us. But in general, I think that's true. With banks, if I believe the $2.2 trillion was signed today or is getting signed today, and as that money gets put into our local economy really over the next week, what I would ask you is that you just be aware of that, because to the extent we can make a short exception for banks or lower it to 500-1 instead of 1,000-1, and that helps facilitate getting the money in our citizens' hands, I'm in favor of that. Most banks now are digital. You can handle pretty much anything. I actually did some banking yesterday that was a traditional in the lobby through the teller line. I also spoke to the particular executive who Michelle referred to, and if they just want to make sure that everyone's safe and they get the money into the hands of the taxpayers. And so I would just say be flexible as that money starts to flow into our community. It'll probably take 3, 4, 5 days, and you'll know a lot more in 3, 4, 5 days too. So
I thought they were going to do all of it electronically, so nobody's going to be sending checks to people's mailboxes.
So I think that's right on the individual $1,200 issue. I'm speaking mostly about small business loans.
Sure, no, they're going to be mailing paper checks to people.
They are.
Yes.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, I think there's going to be small businesses that need to do some banking, and appointment is probably the best way to do it, and that's probably going to be okay. But I would just stay close to that over the next week as that money starts to flow into our community.
I'm happy to do that. Okay, Chuck, welcome to the meeting. And
hey, Chuck.
And the way it's going to work is you have to mute and unmute yourself, and you can do that with your space bar on your keyboard, or else there's a button on the screen if you can figure out how to work that. And our rules of engagement is if you want to talk, unmute yourself, and then I can see that you're wanting to talk. And if you're done talking, then mute yourself, and then I'll know to not call on you. So, Mary Helen, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to add that I do think that making appointments for some of these businesses is the way to go. You know, we're talking about auto repairs or auto shops or bike shops. We could put a note on the door somehow that if you need help, that you call this number and somebody will come to you, rather than having these businesses all open all the time. That might be something to consider along with your banks.
Great. And Chuck, you had something to say?
No, I just joined. I'm just getting off service. So.
Okay. All right. Well, go ahead and mute whenever you don't have something to say. Go ahead and hit the mute button.
Okay. Could somebody recap what you all have talked about real quick? Like,
so far, what we've talked about, probably the main thing is that instead of coming up with standards for each industry that they have to adhere to, turns out that OSHA put out this document, and it's a guidance for workplaces on dealing with COVID. And it classifies jobs into different categories of high risk or very high risk or low risk. And in each one of those categories, then it establishes the kind of personal protective gear that needs to be provided, the any engineering controls or other standards and practices. And I think it's going to be extremely useful for you as a businessman to get a hold of this, because this will cover the funeral industry as well. Okay. You guys are going to be in one of those high or even very high risk areas. And so what we've decided to write into our emergency order, the amendment of which we're working on right now, is that every employer is going to have this available to their employees and training for them. Mm-hmm. It's only a 30-page document. You can run it on your printer and you've got it. Mm-hmm. And secondly, that every there will be a phone number where people can anonymously call in if their workplace is unsafe. And that's we've already got that system set up so that we can respond to that. And we will be adopting these are just guidances by OSHA, but we're going to adopt them as county standards, and therefore they become enforceable. All right. And
I had to mute you because somebody was talking. So
yeah, okay. Anyway, that's probably the main thing. And then we did talk about grocery stores, and I'm inclined, and we had a long conversation about that. I'm inclined to leave it the way it is for right now for the next week or two. We have to renew this basically every week. And so we'll be reviewing it. Mike mainly had concerns about the line outside the stores actually being the unsafest part of it. Mm-hmm. And but right now, we're going to leave the numbers the way they are, but they will be subject to revision next week. And then kind of as you came in, I was talking about, we're basically going to need plan A and plan B. What we're dealing with now is plan B. This is like things are going pretty well. We don't have rampant infections and our hospitals aren't stressed, but we're going to be working on a draft of plan A. And plan A is when things start going a whole lot worse, and we'll have to figure out when to trigger that and plan that. That more stringent plan is what you would call a complete shutdown. It's no services, no construction business, no groceries and pharmacies and healthcare, and that's it. And everybody else is home. And so that's what we may need to go to if what we're doing right now doesn't work. And I don't see any light. Ken, did you want to say something?
No, go ahead.
Okay. So what are what else was on your list, Ken, that we haven't addressed?
I don't have any problem with golf courses as long as people stay 10 feet apart, whenever I play golf, I'm usually in the woods by myself. I went through the rest of your order. It looks fine to me. And so that was all I have for now, and other than some closing comments.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. One other thing, Hutch. Under V, which is airports, I don't know what we're doing to help the governor comply with folks flying in. Maybe the manager can give us an update on that. And I don't know really what you could add into this order to facilitate that, but I did see a couple of emails regarding issues on that.
Madam Manager, do we? Well, I can tell you that we have the right in our order to take anybody's temperature that we want and ask them questions. And if they refuse to cooperate, or if they have a fever over 100.3, I think it is, then they can be denied entry. And I assume that would. I mean, it's not going to be practical if somebody's getting off a plane with a fever to say you got to get back on the plane, but it would require people to comply with isolation and so forth. But Madam Manager, is there anything that we need to consider with respect to the airport or other travel venues?
Mr. Chair, with regard to the airport is operated by a separate entity, and it's also under TSA regulations as well as the governor's order. So I don't know what we can or can't regulate as far as the airport goes. That would be a better question of legal. And I don't know if they've looked into that or if they have an answer that they can give you. But being that it's a separate entity, other than complying with the governor's order, I'm not sure what other measures they're taking right now.
Great. Okay, I'm going to take a 5-minute recess. It's 4:02. We'll come back at 4:07. And this is so that our sign language interpreter can... they can change out and do what they need to do. So we'll be back in 5 minutes.
Hutch, if it's not more than five, I'm going to have to go downtown. So if I'm not here, I've gone to the supervisor of elections.
All right. See y'all in 5 minutes.
All right. Thank you.
The what are any other items that the manager or the attorney believe we need to address in the in amending this order?
Mr. Chair, I can go through my notes and what I've gathered from the discussion here on where we're at. And you can correct me if I'm wrong or if we have to add anything. So with regard to having best practices available or required, we are going to use the OSHA standard and the couple, two or three additional recommendations coming from the attorney's office. Is that only going to apply to construction, real estate, and car dealers, or is that going to apply generally? I'm not sure. I was not clear on that.
Well, I think it should apply to all businesses. And the only trick is, where do you fall in categorizing yourself? Because there's more and more, as we discovered, it's hard to classify businesses because they often do different things, some of which can be very hazardous and some of which aren't. And so it even depends upon the role within the business. If you're a back office person and you work alone, low risk, but if you're the guy who's climbing up the utility pole and dealing with the electricity, that's a high risk. And so what we need to do is put this into place, say it applies to all businesses, and then we need to let the businesses classify themselves. And if they have a problem classifying themselves, then we will have to help them classify themselves. But I don't think that'll end up being necessary.
Okay. On the occupancy side, I have no change to the current occupancy standards, which means the occupancy will remain the same for those services that we've already talked about, such as grocery stores and banks. We're not making any change to the one person per 1,000 square feet I have on my notes. Is that correct?
Yes.
I also have...
Can we talk about occupancy for just a second?
Sure.
So with the occupancy, does that one per 1,000 include, for instance, a parent with two little children? Is that one person?
Well, those are two half people.
Okay. We're going to count half people. Okay. How about family groups? How about, are we counting those as full occupancies, or how are we counting?
That's family groups are a problem because people ought to be encouraged to shop as much as possible, send one person, and they count, adults all count. So I don't think you can, just because you're standing together, you get to cram more people into the store. That's not going to work.
Than adults.
Right.
Adults count.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
May I ask a question about that one too?
Sure.
Taco places. I can't remember the name now.
Yeah, there's a problem that some places have, that they're small and that they won't run people through the line. And the problem is, it's hard to do their business model with social distancing. What they need to do is take the orders, go fix the stuff inside, and bring it out to them.
Like outside, everywhere. Gotcha. That's right. Thank you.
Okay, Michelle.
All right. Then I have we discussed screening of staff, but I'm not sure where we landed on screening of staff.
Well, I think the idea is that it seems like staff in service industries where they're dealing with the public in particular need to be screened fairly frequently, daily or whatever. When you're going to an office and you're pretty much everybody in the office, I'm not sure that the screening requirements are as necessary. So I don't know how we differentiate there. And it's unlikely to happen, although, and I'm not even sure there's enough thermometers out there that people can get a hold of if we make temperature screening a requirement. The actual thermometers are fairly cheap, but I'm guessing right now that they're not to be found anywhere. So I don't know how we make this requirement. I do believe that the requirement that no employee can be disciplined for wearing personal protective gear absolutely needs to be in this order, and it's going to be in there. So go ahead, Madam Manager.
Commissioner Cornell brought up golf courses, but I did not hear any discussion on that, on whether or not.
I don't have a huge problem with golf courses. I have a huge problem with golfing in general, but I don't think that people out golfing are a particular risk, and people do need to get out and enjoy themselves. And we're not limiting frisbee golfing, so I don't think we should limit regular golfing.
Okay, the last one I have on my notes is there was some discussion about taking out and defaulting to the provision that says that groups of 10 or of more than 10 are subject to disbursement. And I just want to make sure that that is what everybody had discussed, especially with Commissioner Chestnut now arriving and not being part of that.
Yeah, Chuck, the way this, there's a clause in here in the amended order, and basically what it says, I'll just read it to you. Pursuant to the governor's executive order 2083 and the health advisory by the Surgeon General, all individuals shall cease participation in social or recreational gatherings of more than 10 people. For all gatherings of fewer than 10 people, individuals shall practice social distancing by maintaining a distance of at least 6 feet from each other. Groups of 10 or more shall be ordered or may be ordered to disperse. And we don't speak to whether this is movie theaters or any other assembly, including churches. And it's the recommendation of the attorney that we not single out churches, that we just lump them in with any other social or recreational gathering. I'm of the opinion that people may not, when they see social and recreational, they may not think in their mind that also means church. And so I might be inclined to say social, recreational, or I don't know, religious gatherings or spiritual gatherings. The point is, I think we need to strongly encourage churches to hold virtual services and not have tons of people coming in. So do you believe that we need to write the word spiritual or religious assemblies in here specifically, or do you think we should leave it out and assume people can get it? Chuck?
Oh, you're asking me a question? I'm sorry.
Yes, sir. Yeah, well, I think...
In reference to...
Yeah, we already had the discussion, but since you weren't here, I wanted to give you allow you to weigh in, because you had brought up specifically churches the last time we met.
Oh, yeah. And I sent an email last night to LaToya to make sure mm-hmm. that all of you all might have saw it or not. But I had some conversation with some ministers, and they want to do what's best and safe for their parishioners. And I understand that. But they're having some concerns. If they could just get the information and instead of just getting it by newspaper and all of that, so they can inform their church or their members of what is going on, instead of getting it secondhand from the newspaper or television. And they just wanted to have that dialogue with the county. And I've also heard from barbershops but I know that online there's a way for those businesses that feel that they're essential to apply and also state their purpose for that. But I think that my concerns is how long does that take, and how long will they be approved to be an essential business? The guidelines don't say that online, so. Just some clarity there.
Our standard is
yesterday there was an article in the you're breaking up.
Okay, go ahead, you talk.
No, no, you just, I get a slur. As you make a word, it slurs, and I can't hear the rest.
Well, our standard for getting back to people is 48 hours. Now, we had a huge...
48 hours.
Okay. Yeah, we had a huge slug of them right at the beginning, so it may, and we had to figure out our process. But generally speaking, we believe 48 hours is the right turnaround time for when somebody appeals, and then they'll hear from us.
Okay.
And Mr. Chair, there is a place on the portal that the county created that you can click on that says decisions, and we're putting them on it. We're continuously updating a spreadsheet so that actually before anybody puts in a request, they can look on that spreadsheet to see if we've already answered what they're seeking to do. They won't have to go through that. And right now, last time I looked, we were up to 15 pages on an Excel spreadsheet of decisions we've already made.
And they do get some, and Michelle, they do get some kind of direct feedback either by email or letter to tell them of the decision, so that we're not relying on people to go to a spreadsheet, are we?
At this point in time, we tell them that their decision will be posted on that site, because when we started having to send, we were up to almost 300, and to have to send out those separately, it was becoming onerous because they were coming in so fast. We were getting 150 a day. So what we tell people is, wow, check the that site online, and your decision will be posted within a certain amount of time.
All right, Ken.
Thank you, Ms. Chair. I want to thank a number of the pastors. I've had a lot of conversations with the churches, and they and I saw that you approved Touch a second farm share event, which I think is great. You know, my message and their message to us is, how can we help feed folks? How can we set up systems where our parishioners are getting fed? They understand, the ones I talk to really understand the need to go online with their services for the next couple of weeks and just kind of change the way they're doing things. So I support the changes to paragraph 16, Hutch. I want you to know that. I want to just verify that I'm looking at the right draft. My draft has the wording that the attorney added under J, automobile dealers, used and new, realtors and construction sites. Is that your draft, Hutch? And then the,
yes, yeah,
and mm-hmm, the realtors and the business associated with that, that's I?
Yes.
Okay, so that's good. I'm good with all that. Okay. So I'll just save my comments for the end unless you need me on anything.
Nope. That's,
and you're going to add golf courses.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Chuck, go ahead.
Yeah, I didn't get to finish. There was an article in the Gainesville Sun yesterday from a Sarasota attorney with, I guess, the Sarasota County Commission. He was indicating that we don't have the authority to do the stay-at-home kind of stuff and that stuff. So I just wanted the attorney to clarify that, because I had a lot of people to also call me yesterday in reference to what they read in the paper. And so I just wanted some clarity that we do have that authority or we don't have that authority, because he was saying that the governor has that authority and not county governments.
So, Mr. Chair, let me start with what you were reading in the Gainesville Sun was a newspaper account of another newspaper account of a memorandum that was sent to the county commission in Sarasota County by their internal county attorney. Okay. So take it from that perspective. Okay. It's gone through a number of iterations and a number of non-lawyers.
Well, everybody added their 2 cents to it.
Well, they added their understanding to it. Okay. They took their pieces out of it and they added their understanding to it. I don't fault anybody for any kind of misinterpretation. I did, when you sent your letter this morning, and I appreciate the heads up on that, I asked the county attorney from Sarasota County to share with me that memo, and I have it, and I'm happy to share it with you.
Okay.
It came to me.
Does not say that.
it came to me, well, right, it does not say what they said it said, but it came to me with an email that basically said, that's not what I said. What was said was not what I said. This is what I said, the memo. And I think you know that when you get a whole bunch of county attorneys in a room, we're going to have disagreements about things, and we're going to be in a
different interpretation of the law. Mm-hmm.
But we've had the question of the county's authority, emergency authority, asked a number of times since this order went out, and I've shared, and I do have it in writing, and I'm happy to read sort of like what our basis is. Before I do that, I mean, I can go down the list currently of the different local jurisdictions that clearly disagree with the one county attorney who made the news on this. Alachua County has a stay-at-home order. Broward County has a stay-at-home order. Collier County, Duval County, Escambia, Hernando, Hillsborough, Lee, Leon, Manatee, Miami-Dade, Osceola, Orange, Okaloosa has a beach closure. Osceola, Palm Beach has closed non-essential businesses and their beaches. Pasco County has social distancing recommendations. Pinellas, and that's P. You know, I can keep going. So Sarasota doesn't currently. Their attorney has taken what I consider to be the far conservative end of the approach. There is, of course, a far liberal end, and we are somewhere in the middle on sort of the spectrum of how to interpret that. And I'm happy to read in the statutes, but what I'm telling you is that's one attorney, and he made the news because he took what I think is out of the norm.
The other thing to know is earlier today I signed this emergency order, and basically it lays out our authority because of the very questions you're talking about.
Okay. Right.
And it has all those bases in it. And I, like I said, I can read it into the record if you'd like me to, or I can share it with you in writing. But I think the reason his particular opinion made the news is because it's out of the norm.
Oh, okay. Sounds good. Thank you.
All right. Madam Manager, do you have anything else to add?
No, that looks like everything I had taken notes on, I think we've covered, unless... Okay. Has anything.
Okay, so let me just move on away from the emergency order now and talk about how we're going to conduct business in the future and what our upcoming schedule looks like. We want to be able to have a normal county commission meeting, and we want to be able to take public input. There's no practical way to open the phone lines, for instance, and just take input. And so what we're going to do, if we can technologically figure it out, is when a motion goes on the floor, we'll open it for public input, and people can write their input. We'll give them 5 minutes, and they can write it by text, they can write it on an email, or they can write it on Facebook or something like that. And we will have operators standing by who will collect all that information and then basically give it to us as a dump of text that then we will spend the time to read. And so it has a couple of advantages. One is multiple ways that people can get their concerns to us. People can write their concerns prior to when I open it up. So if there's something about it they don't like, they can write it and then just hit the send button. And then finally, it creates a nice text public record for what the input was that we based our decision on. So I think that's going to be the most practical way to do this. We have not exactly worked out technically how it will happen. It may seem like the meetings go slow because for 5 minutes we'll be twiddling our thumbs or whatever, but in reality, it would be quicker than if we opened the phone lines and gave everybody 3 minutes to talk to us, because the first meeting like this we had, there were 8,000 people watching. And if each one of them decide, and plus it could potentially even crash the county phone system, is what I've been told, is if 50 or 100 people called in, wanted to make record a 3-minute message to us, and then we listen to them in order, just do the math. First of all, it could take hours to listen to them all. And second, it would... technologically possibly even break our system, which would potentially affect other critical phone lines. So that's what we're working on. The attorney hasn't told me we can't do it this way. The manager is working on how we'll do it this way. And unless I hear any other concerns, that's how we'll have our next couple of county commission meetings. And Madam Manager, we were going over the calendar today. Is the next likely meeting of this board where we're taking motions on April the 14th?
All right, if you're moving on, Hutch, I wanted to jump in there.
Yeah, well, hang on. Let me get the manager to confirm. Is April 14th, Madam Manager, when we need to have this up and running?
Yes, we looked at the April 7th calendar today, and there's only one item that we felt was necessary, and because of that, for the month of April. So because of that, we're going to put that on the regular meeting agenda for April 14th, so we can try to have the least amount of meetings this way.
Great. Commissioner Byerly.
So just to toss another model into the mix, and I'm not saying this is better or worse, it's just that when I'm told what Marion County is doing, it seemed kind of interesting to me. I don't know if any of you are familiar with that, but they are actually still having county commission gatherings where they meet as a group, but they space way out and they do things differently. There's no public in the room with them, but in a nearby physical location where people can be properly controlled and spaced, they're allowed to speak into a microphone directly into a video feed that goes to the commissioners. So they essentially virtually do the same thing we do in our meetings, but people are spaced out separately.
So and how does that comply with our stay-at-home order?
I don't know if it does or not.
It doesn't.
That's what they're doing.
Yeah, well, they don't have a stay-at-home order.
That's true.
Okay. Ken?
Since that is the meeting that we're going to be adopting the rules, what is your time frame for when you want to put those rules in place? Because that gives me plenty of time to kind of circle around to the commissioners that have stay-at-home orders. I know that many, many commissions prior to all this starting took public comment at the beginning of the meeting for everything on the agenda. And that's another a way to think about getting public comment on the front end. Get it loaded in for a period of time, gives us a time to then consider it as the things come up. And I think it is just another model. So I think
I guess the concern is we don't have the technological capability for people to call in simultaneously and record dozens or hundreds of messages, and which is what would happen, I think. And we don't have, and then if we just imagine if we say we're opening it for public comment for anything on the agenda, and then we are going to, in real time, listen to all those comments, we could be here for hours and hours listening to people giving us their opinion of everything that we're doing before the meeting even starts.
Yeah, I mean, I know in Putnam County, they take public comment for anything on the agenda, and they have a period of time. It's a 30-minute block. I know the school board has a 15-minute block. So I don't have an opinion yet, Hutch, because, again, I need to speak to some other folks that are with a stay-at-home order, to your point. But I think the decision point of we have to adopt our rules would be either you adopt them prior to the 14th and then we try to modify them in that meeting if we don't like them, or we adopt them up until that time. And so I think we have a little bit of time on that.
Yeah, I do. And the other thing is, frankly, under that scenario, the best thing, and what I've been telling people to do about this meeting, they want to have input in this meeting, I say, contact your commissioners. They're all incredibly easy to get a hold of, and you know that because you've been getting plenty of direct input, because what you're saying is if you could comment prior to the meeting, well, prior to the meeting is any time you want. It could be the middle of the night in your underwear, and you can be typing an email to a commissioner. And so essentially I'm suggesting that if we're talking about an item on the agenda, that all of that information be sent to us, and that we're fast readers. We can digest it. We can get the gist of things. The big problem is that, well, there's two issues. One is that some people come to public meeting not to talk to us, but to talk to the public in general. And so they sort of lose that. But our emails are open public records, so anybody can look at what's going out there. So I don't have as big a problem with that part of it. But the other is that often when people speak in a public meeting, others agree, and they don't feel like they have to come up and make the same point. So if 100 people are sitting in a meeting and one person makes a good point, the other 99 don't necessarily come up and make that same point. That won't happen if everybody's independently giving us their input. So Facebook helps because you can watch as comments scroll by, you can add yours and you can sort of see what other people are saying. But not everybody has the Facebook capability. So that's why I want to have at least three channels: direct text, direct email, and then social media. All right. So I see nobody begging to talk about that. Is there any other business that needs to come to us? If not, then I'll open it up for each commissioner to make a statement. Ken, you're first. Go ahead, Ken.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair. So just a few things I wanted to just tell the folks that are out there listening that I want to thank the hundreds of people that have communicated to me personally, and I know to our board in general, via voicemail, phone, text, email, whatever method they've used. It's been very, very appreciative for me. I know making hard decisions sooner is exponentially important in this time. South Korea, first 30 cases weren't a big deal, but their 31st case, that person spread it to 1,000 people. And so every potential case that we can prevent could exponentially really help save our healthcare workers, our first responders, and all of our essential folks that are working. From my perspective, the next two weekends I think are critical. I think statewide, we are beginning to see an exponential increase. And if we can keep the numbers low, it's going to mean a lot. I want to thank the churches and the pastors for kind of leaning in right now. A number of them have done a lot in our community to help their parishioners. And every person that they help is one less person in need. So I want to thank them personally. To my fellow colleagues in the adjoining counties, if you don't have cases, it doesn't mean it's not there. And I will just use three counties that had four cases a week ago: Marion, Putnam, and Clay. Clay County had four, the other two had zero. Those three counties now have 42 cases. And so I would ask that the adjacent counties not just look at their county, look at what's happening in our county and take whatever measures they can take to help us. I think it's important statewide that we as county commissioners are communicating with our colleagues across the state, but certainly the ones that are close to us. Hutch, I appreciate you sending that order out to the fellow commissioners. I'd ask that you continue to do that, and I'm certainly following up those with phone calls for the ones that I know. The last thing I'll say is people ask me, what can I do? You know, if you are non-essential, you can stay home. That's the biggest thing you can do. Reach out to your neighbor. Help the elderly. I've had a number of my friends that are going grocery shopping for their elderly parents or their elderly neighbors, and they're doing it in the middle of the day. They're not doing it before work. They're not doing it after work. The more we can help our healthcare workers, our first responders, our central workers, our business owners, the more we get to protect our community. And so if you see something that's going on with a business owner, talk to them. Every single business owner that I have talked to, without exception, from building construction to realtors to small businesses, are doing everything they can to protect their employees, their families, and whatever we can do together has been very, very helpful. So thanks for having this meeting. Let's just keep working together. So that's it. Thanks.
Thank you very much for those comments, Mike. Mike has nothing. And Chuck?
I have nothing, but I also wanted to know, have you all been in contact with the mayors and the small municipalities to discuss this issue with them also?
Yes, every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 9:30, okay, we have a meeting with them, and they've made great suggestions. And they're, they're doing a good job of rounding up the people who are in need in their communities. And we normally kind of know who we think are people in need, but now it may well be somebody who's got a car, somebody who normally we would never think about delivering food to, but now they're sheltering in place because they may have a medical condition or they're of age like me. I mean, my wife is totally quarantined. She's not going anywhere. And so I'm the guy who has to go out shopping and doing the errands because she's immunocompromised and is not going to expose herself. So, we are working very closely with them. On Monday, there's a conference call between the all the county managers and county chairs of the surrounding counties that surround Marion County. So they sort of set it up for the group surrounding them. So that'll be a very interesting call for me to participate in. So I'm looking forward to that. And I want to just say, go ahead, Chuck, you want to finish up?
I think that was my concern. Okay. I think in my email, so I don't know if you guys saw that. So I just wanted to make sure that got clarified because they want to be in the loop and they want to be able to give input on some of our decisions. Right. So I think that was important to have the mayors in those municipalities to weigh in on our order. So
Right. That's
it. I have nothing else to say other than that.
Good. Thank you. So I'll just say two things. I'll say three things. One is I've been incredibly heartened by the response of people to what we're doing in Alachua County. And for every naysayer or doubter, there's a dozen people who say we're on the right course. The graph actually shows it, and you probably can't see that. But of the five top counties for infections, all of them are showing the exponential rise going up except Alachua County, which is starting to tip over. And the other thing I'll say is if you have any doubt about what public input could be like in a meeting, this meeting has had 800 comments on Facebook just while we've been doing it. So the final thing I'll say is that great story about when JFK was taking a tour of NASA in 1961, and he's walking down a hall and there's a janitor mopping the floor, and he asked the janitor, "What are you doing?" And the janitor said, "Well, I'm helping put a man on the moon." And so the analog today is when somebody asks you what you're doing, your answer should be, "I'm saving somebody's life." And that's the actions that we're taking. That's the actions that people who are staying at home are taking. That's the action that the people who go to work every day in our essential industries, the healthcare workers, the first responders, the grocery clerks, and the many others. And that's what we need to do as a community, is we need to be saving lives. And with that, this meeting is adjourned.